Let's read together Lord's Day 21 of the Heidelberg Catechism. Lord's Day 21, our focus will be on the first of the three question and answers, that dealing with the Holy Catholic Church. What believest thou concerning the Holy Catholic Church of Christ, that the Son of God, from the beginning to the end of the world, gathers, defends, and preserves to himself, by his Spirit and Word, out of the whole human race, a church chosen to everlasting life, agreeing in true faith, and that I am, and forever shall remain, a living member thereof? What do you understand by the communion of saints? First, that all and everyone who believes, being members of Christ, are in common partakers of him and of all his riches and gifts. Secondly, that everyone must know it to be his duty, readily and cheerfully, to employ his gifts for the advantage and salvation of other members. What believest thou concerning the forgiveness of sins? That God, for the sake of Christ's satisfaction, will no more remember my sins, neither my corrupt nature, against which I have to struggle all my life long, but will graciously impute to me the righteousness of Christ, that I may never be condemned before the tribunal of God. I believe in Holy Catholic Church, so states the Apostles' Creed. The historic Roman Catholic interpretation of this is, to put it bluntly, I believe that Rome is the Holy Catholic Church. That's their position. I believe whatever the Pope and his church says is right. I don't even need to know what he says. I receive it with an implicit faith. Whatever he says, no matter what, some of the time not even interested in learning, says the average Roman Catholic, it's bound to be right. And I believe that whatever the Roman Catholic Church does is, therefore, by definition, right. That is the historic Roman Catholic teaching, expressed very boldly, but that's it. Of course, in modern Roman Catholicism, especially in the Western world, there's a great spirit of secularism, so most Roman Catholics don't really care that much about what he says, the Pope, because the system is disintegrating. But there are still people today in the Roman Church, and that is their faith. And that is what they believe the line in the Apostle Creed means. Now, at the other extreme is what we might call the Anabaptistic standpoint, whereby the only thing that is important is my relationship to God through Jesus Christ, the individual perspective. As for the church, or the collective or corporate body, I don't really have any need for it. And it has no significant place in my life and my thinking. And that reveals itself by the fact that it really does have no significant place in their life or their thinking. And if, in this Anabaptistic standpoint, in some sense the person does accept the idea of the church, it's grudgingly, and without the church having any real authority over me. The person is distant to the church, sits loose to the church, they hardly ever even think of it. And this too is not the meaning of I believe an holy Catholic Church either. The biblical and reformed view is between these two very ugly extremes. We believe, of course, the personal salvation of all who trust in Christ crucified by grace alone. Because whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. There's an important individual aspect where the soul of the sinner stands before God. And we believe the church, a corporate body. This too is an article of our faith, and it greatly affects and helps our Christian life and practice. We don't say it's all the church and nothing about the individual before God. We don't say, well, it's all the individual before God and therefore we don't need the church. We say both together, that's biblical and reformed. And tonight we're going to look at believing the church. First, the church's invisibility. Second, the church's institution. And third, the church's attributes. Believing the church, its invisibility, its institution, and its attributes. What then is the perspective of the Apostles' Creed on the church and its explanation in Lord's Day 21 of our Heidelberg Catechism? The church here is not the object of sight. It doesn't say, I see an holy Catholic church. It says, I believe an holy Catholic church. And you don't believe something that you can see. The church here is not the object of faith in the sense of I believe in the church, as if we trusted in the church for salvation, as if the church saved us. The Apostles' Creed begins, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord. I believe in the Holy Spirit. And then the word in is scored out in the next line. I believe an holy Catholic Church. You believe or trust in God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit as your God, Lord, Savior. You believe the church, but you don't believe in it as if it were your God or it were your Savior. It's not. The church is not the object of sight. The church is not the object of faith in the sense I've just explained. The perspective of the Apostles' Creed and Lord's Day 21 is that the church is an article of faith. An article of faith that we believe. Because faith is the substance or realization of things hoped for, the evidence or conviction of things not seen. Faith deals with invisible realities. And not every invisible reality, but invisible realities taught in Scripture. Believing an holy Catholic Church, therefore, deals, first of all, with believing the Church invisible as an article of faith. And if you ask, well, when did this Church invisible begin? The answer is before the foundation of the world, before creation, before time. Ephesians 1 verse 4 is proof. He hath chosen us, the church, in Christ before the foundation of the world. And that's why answer 54 of our Heidelberg Catechism says that we believe a church chosen or elected to everlasting life. Believing the church, therefore, means, this is biblical, reformed, creedal Christianity, believing in eternal election. Believing the eternal election of the church. Believing that eternal election is the source of the church. This is what it is to believe the church. You believe in the election of the church. And here, at one stroke, you realize that most of the speaking and thinking and preaching and teaching in the visible churches regarding the church is completely wrong. This is never mentioned, and this is denied. The church is the product of man's own free will. He adds himself to the body. He is like a stone that picks himself up and slaps himself down on the wall and integrates himself into the building of God's temple. And you say to them, how wrong can you be? That isn't the biblical teaching of the church at all. This truth about believing the church and therefore believing its origin or source in eternal election is an important aspect of the invisibility of the church, because you and I, though embraced in the eternal election of the church, you and I were not there to behold it, to view God's eternal decree of the election of the church. God has not given to us a copy of the Lamb's Book of Life for us to read. We believe it because the Scripture teaches it. Believing the church invisible includes believing not only its eternal election, but also its gathering. The gathering of the church is that history-long work of Jesus Christ by his word and spirit, whereby he brings to himself, through faith, all of the elect in all of the world. That is, in time and history, Jesus Christ gathers all his elect to himself by faith alone, through his word and Holy Spirit. And this, too, is an article of our faith, or an aspect of an article of our faith concerning the church. Jesus said in Matthew 16, verse 18, I will build my church. That's a promise. That's a statement of what Jesus Christ will do. And the Christian believes that. That's invisible. Question and answer 54. What believest thou concerning the Holy Catholic Church of Christ? Answer, that the Son of God, from the beginning to the end of the world, gathers to himself a church. I believe that the Son gathers a church. That's faith, not sight. This may have been part of the problem of John Mark, a struggle with believing the gathering of the church during the start of Paul's first missionary journey in Acts 13. Because John Mark, as you will remember, left Paul and Barnabas after their missionary labors at Cyprus, which was only about a third of the way through. Apparently, John Mark believed that the gathering of the church should be quicker and or easier and or attended with less opposition. And so, partway through the journey, he packed up and went home. He wasn't interested in spending any more time and effort at this stage in his life working at the gathering of the church. And what do those who believe in the gathering of the church do? They witness. Because they want to be used in the great work of Jesus Christ in gathering the church. They invite others to hear the preaching of God's word, because Jesus Christ is gathering his church by his word and Holy Spirit. They give out gospel literature in the hope that it may be a means that God uses to gather his church. And they pray that the Lord of the harvest would send forth laborers into his harvest, because the fields are white already unto harvest. as Jesus tells us in Luke chapter 10. I believe in Holy Catholic Church means I believe in its eternal election, and I believe in its historical gathering. And it also means I believe in its preservation. Now, the preservation of the church means that the elect and gathered church will be kept in its salvation. That is, all the flock, considered collectively, and each individual sheep or lamb, not one of them goes lost. None of them perish. All receive everlasting life. The classic biblical example of someone who doubted the preservation of the church is Elijah. The man was run down, tired and hungry. He's been battling with Ahab and that wicked wife of his for years. He has engaged in a titanic struggle with the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel, and his expectations have now been proven terribly wrong. There was no mass conversion of the northern kingdom back to the living God. And he had so hoped and thought that that's what would happen when God sent rain. But then he gets word that Queen Jezebel is seeking to slay him, and he thinks that it's all over, it's all finished. So he complains to God that he's the only one left. Not a bit of wonder the man was depressed. Anybody believing those lies would be depressed too. His faith was weak, and God told him in 1 Kings 19 and Romans 11 that he, the Almighty, had reserved unto himself, and you could add, instead of reserved, you could add preserved unto himself, slip a P in there, the meaning's the same, that he had reserved unto himself 7,000 who had not bowed the knee to Baal. In spite of the shocking apostasy of the church, in spite of its invisibility, there were still 7,000 in the northern kingdom who hadn't bowed the knee to Baal. That's question and answer 54. What do you believe concerning the Holy Catholic Church of Christ? Answer: that the Son of God, from the beginning to the end of the world, gathers, defends, and preserves to himself, out of the whole human race, a church chosen to everlasting life. You need to believe the election of the church. You need to believe the gathering of the church, especially if you're a missionary. You need to believe the preservation of the church. And the latter you especially need to believe in days of institutional declension and defection, when everything looks as if it's gone to the dogs, as it did in Elijah's day. The northern kingdom, hopelessly apostate. It's had the worst king out of several unbelieving kings, and the worst wife, and the prophets are being killed. And you've got to believe that God preserves his church. The other time when you especially need to believe in the preservation of the church is upon the apostasy of individuals. When someone rejects the faith or falls into gross sin or doesn't repent after church admonition, you need to believe in the preservation of the church, especially if they're friends, especially if they're family, especially if they're office bearers. And what I mean is, you need to believe the preservation of the church in that those who apostatize and do not come back are not the church. It's the preservation of the church. It doesn't mean that God will preserve every individual person who confesses to be a true Christian. It's the preservation of the true church, those who really are elect, those who have been gathered. Not everybody who makes a profession or warms a pew. 1 John 2, verse 19. They went out from us, but they were not of us. Well, why do you say that, John? Ah, for if they had been of us, they would, no doubt, have continued with us. But they went out, that they may be made manifest that they were not of us even in the first place. That's the biblical and reformed teaching about apostasy. The church is preserved, but they weren't truly church in the first place. Instead, they've revealed their true colours. See, this is the same John who has written, I give unto my sheep eternal life, and they shall never perish. And then this same John sees people, including leaders, defect from the truth, go into the world, remain impenitent, never come back. And he says they went out from us because they were never really of us in the first place. What I taught, in other words, about the preservation of the church, stands firm, because they really weren't church at all. The believer needs to know the preservation of the church, not only regarding other people, if they go haywire, but also regarding himself. And this too is taught in question and answer 54. What do you believe about the Holy Catholic Church? Well, that the Son of God gathers, defends, and preserves to himself the church. That's the corporate. And, moving towards the end, and I believe too that I am and forever shall remain a living member thereof. That's my comfort. That I'm not going to be cast off, because I truly do believe from the heart the preservation of the church means for each child of God also the preservation of me. Because without being selfish, you need to be included in this. It's no good to us if everybody else in the church are saved and we perish. We need to be part of that party, and we need to know that we're included. Believing the church's invisibility involves believing its eternal election, its history-long gathering, and its complete preservation of the whole and every true member, and believing the church's invisibility also includes believing the church latent. That word latent may need some explanation. That which is latent is concealed or hidden or not yet manifest. You can't see it. The church latent includes those who are elect but are not yet born. And not yet even conceived. 100 years ago, we were all members of the church latent. Nobody knew us. We weren't yet conceived or born. And believing the church latent is a great motivation for Christian couples to have children. If you didn't believe in the election of the church, and you didn't believe that God saves his elect out of the children of believers, you'd wonder, should we have children at all? But God's covenant salvation is with believers and their seed. I will be a God unto you and to your seed after you, Abraham. Genesis 17. And then he and his wife Sarah kept on trying, and God gave him a seed, Isaac. Then there are others in the church latent who are elect, and they have been born, but they haven't been gathered yet. They're unbelieving, wicked, hard-hearted, rebellious. Maybe they've rejected the gospel a dozen times, but they're still elect, and they will be called. How many times had Paul heard the gospel from faithful Christians whom he was persecuting? And then one day Jesus spoke to him and he repented. And this is the motivation of the church for evangelism, personal witnessing, and for missions. You need to believe in the church latent, that there are elect people out there who haven't yet been called, or else when you get told, oh, I'm not interested in that, you're a religious fanatic, I don't even want one of your pamphlets, would you get lost and give me a break? You're going to say, well, I'm not going to bother anymore. But you just keep sowing because there are elect out there. You've got to believe in the church latent. If there is no church latent, who could find it in themselves to do any evangelism whatsoever? Because it's not pleasant being used to harden unbelievers when you bring them the truth so they reject it. It's inevitable, it happens, but if you were told that that was what's going to happen with everybody and nobody was going to be converted, you'd say, well, I've had enough, I'm packing it in. Believing the church's invisibility involves not only believing the church latent, those who haven't yet been gathered, but also believing the church triumphant, those who have been gathered into heaven. The church above, where Jesus Christ is at the God's right hand in the presence of the angels. And the church triumphant is invisible to us. You have never seen the church triumphant. And the charismatic preachers and the Romanists who've said that they've been translated to heaven and they've seen all these people, you know what? They haven't seen it either. And people who say that are indicating that that's not where they're headed anyway, because they're telling you lies. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are in the kingdom. And we know that, not because your minister has been there on a transcendental trip, but because Jesus said that in Matthew chapter 8, you will sit one day with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom. Moses and Elijah, we believe that they are in the church triumphant because the pair of them appeared to Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. The heroes of the faith mentioned in Hebrews 11, Samson and Gideon and David and Solomon and all the rest, they're in the church triumphant. A vast multitude that no man can number. And the comfort for us individually is that when we die, we will go to join the church triumphant. The church in glory, triumphing. No more fighting to be done, only victory. Absent from the body, present with the Lord as a member of the church triumphant. This comfort, too, extends to us regarding those who have died in the Lord before us. Paul teaches this in 1 Thessalonians 4. I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, so that you do not sorrow, even as the others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus, dead believers, God will bring with him, with Jesus. For the Lord himself, at his second coming, shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Not the believers who are currently on the earth, but the dead in Christ will rise first. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. God doesn't want you worrying about your believing cousin or granny who died. He gives you comfort. They're in the church triumphant. They're in a far, far better place than we are. Sorrow because you've lost them, but don't sorrow for them. They wouldn't want you to be sorry for them. All their tears are wiped away. Believing the church, and now we come to the second point in our sermon, believing the church also includes believing that Jesus Christ will form instituted, organized churches. We're moving from invisibility, that which you can't see, to that which is visible to some extent. When I speak of an instituted church or an organized church, these include office bearers, pastor, elders, there are a plurality in the Bible, deacons. Instituted churches include the preaching of the word, sacramental administration, baptism and the Lord's Supper, and church discipline, and a definite, recognizable membership, so that people know, in this sense it's like other societies, who's a member and who isn't. The proof of this is found in Matthew 16 again, Jesus' famous words at Caesarea Philippi. Matthew 16, verses 18 and 19. Jesus said, "I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee, Peter, and thus the other apostles, and thus the prophets, evangelists, and pastors, and teachers who succeeded them, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Christ builds his church, and he gives to the church the keys of the kingdom of heaven, which are, for you know, Lord's Day 31, two keys: preaching, Matthew 16, and church discipline, Matthew 18. Ah, but it's only an instituted church which has preaching and church discipline. So when Jesus said he will build the church and he will give the keys of the kingdom to that church, he's going to build the church not only of people but in an organized, instituted form. And then you see such a church has the sacraments, because the point of the sacraments is to reinforce and serve as an adjunct to preaching. So then you get baptism and the Lord's Supper. And of course, church discipline determines who can come to baptism and the Lord's Supper. And then, of course, if there's the keys of the kingdom of heaven, preaching and church discipline, and preaching comes with the sacraments, well, then you need office bearers to do the preaching, to administer the sacraments, to exercise church discipline. And, of course, you need membership to avail of the preaching, to use the sacraments, to be preserved through church discipline. I will build my church, and I will build my church in such a way that there's the keys of the kingdom of heaven in instituted congregations. The invisible church will become visible in institutional form. And that is the relationship between the church invisible and the church institute. The church institute, like this congregation, is a manifestation of the church invisible on earth. The invisible church doesn't stay or remain invisible in all aspects. It becomes visible. It becomes manifest. Invisible, instituted congregations. Because Jesus Christ, by his word and spirit, gathers his church, gathers his elect to salvation in an instituted church. And this is the motivation for missionary work. Not just saving some souls, that's important, but saving souls with the goal that they will be able to form a congregation with office bearers and the Lord's Supper as an instituted church. This is why you pray. You pray that the Lord will convert people from darkness and bring others who already are Christians into a deeper knowledge of the truth, and that they all may be united and of sufficient strength and numbers that you can pick office bearers. Sound men to lead the fledgling church. That's mission work, and that's the point of praying for it. Jesus said, "I will build my church. I'll give to it the keys of the kingdom of heaven." Therefore, there will be a church institute. And you believe that. And then you pray and labor with that hope and motivation. Now, more needs to be said, though, as regards believing the church's institution, because we are not called to believe that every instituted church is a true church institute. In fact, we are called to believe that there are many church institutes which are synagogues of Satan. You can have an institute that calls itself a church, and it might even call itself the church on earth, and Christ's chief and most blessed church on earth, as the harlot church of Rome does. An individual congregation or denomination may claim, "We're a church, we're faithful. Look at our office bearers, look at our members, look at our preaching, look at our sacraments, look at our discipline." And they may point to many other things besides. But the calling of the Christian is to evaluate the church biblically, not believe every church and not believe every claim of every church either. 1 John 4 verse 1 says, "Try the spirits." The Christian, as a prophet, is called to evaluate individual church teachers. You could just as easily say, since the spirits or the prophets serve in connection with churches, the call is, try the churches. The places where they teach. Try them too. Beloved, to quote that verse more fully, believe not every spirit, or every church in which every spirit spouts forth his ideas, but try the spirits, and therefore also the churches in which they promulgate their views, try the spirits, whether they be of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. And here's the problem. You get so many people in the world and in the professing Christian world, and they say, "Oh, that's a church. Therefore, it must be a church. Therefore, it is a church. They're all equally good churches." But they forget that the Bible says there are many false prophets gone out into the world. There are many of them. The countries follow them. Every country's follow them. And they have churches and they have followers. So you have to test or try the spirits. If Scripture said in the New Testament age there will be no false prophets, no false Christs, no false teachers, then it would say, you don't need to test a single church teacher, you don't need to test any churches, because there are no false Christians and false teachers about. Just believe everybody, take them at face value. But that's emphatically not the Bible's teaching. Believing the church means believing that instituted churches are more or less pure according to their faithfulness to the three marks of a true church. Belgic Confession 29, and this is typical for the Reformation Creed, states that we test the church by the faithfulness of its preaching, the faithfulness of its sacramental administration, baptism and the Lord's Supper, and the faithfulness of its church discipline. Those are the tests. Not anything else, not anything added to it, not anything taken away. Those are the tests. So believing the church means, for the child of God, that I understand it to be my duty before the Almighty to join and therefore to remain in a faithful church which manifests clearly the three marks. That's what it means to believe the church. That's Belgic Confession 28 too. Join and remain in. It means also that I am called to worship, serve in, and thrive in that church. And that's what every church member should do. Not only join and remain in the church. That's not too hard. You can get your name on the little list with your address and telephone number and email number. But worship in the church, serve in the church, and thrive in the church. Everybody should be serving, worshiping, and thriving. Yeah. And why not? Why not? And here come in all the admonitions, and there are dozens of them, to us as church members, found especially in the New Testament, and particularly within the practical parts of the New Testament epistles regarding lively membership in the church. Love one another, serve one another, care for one another, help one another, encourage one another, admonish one another. Question and answer 55 of Lord's Day 22. What do you understand by the communion of the saints? And here it means the communion of the saints in the Holy Catholic Church of Christ, as the previous article makes clear. First, that all, collectively, and everyone, individually, who believes, being members of Christ, are, in common, partakers of him and of all his riches and gifts. There, be happy. Secondly, that everyone must know it to be his duty, readily and cheerfully, to employ his gifts for the advantage and salvation of other members. So a faithful institute church is God's flock, Christ's body, the temple of the Holy Spirit, and a manifestation of the kingdom of God on earth. And that is the sphere in which God saves his believing people. God gathers the elect through and in a faithful church institute. God preserves his elect through and in a faithful church institute. And now finally, believing the church includes believing the church's attributes. Four key qualities that the Bible and church traditions and confessions have attributed to the church. Unity. We believe there is one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I believe an holy, Catholic church. We believe the unity of the church, even though there are hundreds and thousands of denominations and congregations all around the world. And we believe that not the way the ecumenists believe it. Oh, isn't it awful? Oh, this is terrible. Very, very hard to believe this. Oh, it's such a struggle for my faith to get my head around. Get a grip. Yeah, of course there are Roman Catholic churches. Loads of them. Eastern Orthodox churches. Anabaptist churches. Lutheran. Reformed. Presbyterian. Congregational. Baptist churches. Why does this surprise you? Does the Bible not speak of this sort of thing? Does the Bible ever talk about apostasy? You better believe it. Does the Bible ever talk about heresy? Does the Bible ever talk about schism? Does the Bible talk about false teachers? Does the Bible talk about many false teachers and the many people who follow them? It's no wonder that there are so many churches. Because many of them are false churches. And the other ones have degrees of faithfulness so that where there's a multiplicity in one area, somebody says, well, I don't want to go to that church because that church teaches the truth and I have all these sins that I'm never going to give up on. So I'll go to this church over there that they'll never preach anything too sharp and it'll not even affect my conscience. And then there'll be another church for people who like all sorts of music and so forth, so they can be entertained with music and so forth. So there are lots of churches for different people and where they're at. Yeah, of course. It's a consumerist world. The churches buy into that. It isn't really any surprise. You know what really would be a surprise? If there was one big super church that was really faithful and there weren't any other church, I would go to the Bible and say, wow, I think the Bible's wrong. Because the Bible talked about apostasy and division and schism and so forth. And it's not even there. It said there are many false prophets and many false Christians. This is exactly what you would expect if you take the scriptures seriously. The unity of the church, you see, isn't that they all have the same sign above the door. The unity of the church is, as Ephesians 4 teaches, there's one baptism, the spiritual baptism of regeneration. There's one faith. There's one Lord. There's one God. Therefore, there's one body animated by one Spirit and one hope of our calling. And Ephesians 4, 4 through 6 is the greatest explanation of church unity found anywhere of the Bible. It's concise and dense, and it's a spiritual, organic unity. And this unity is sought not without the truth or against the truth, which is, in one short sentence, the obliteration of the ecumenical efforts by the false and departing churches over the last 150 years. The unity of the church is sought in the truth and through the truth. What do you believe concerning the Holy Catholic Church of Christ? Answer, that the Son of God, from the beginning to the end of the world, gathers, defends, and preserves to himself by his Spirit and Word, out of the whole human race, a church chosen to everlasting life, agreeing in true faith. That's what we believe. That's Christian. This is the only unity worth a hoot. Unity in the truth, the unity of Jesus Christ himself. And our calling is believe the biblical unity and not be deceived by the siren calls of the false ecumenists. And seek biblical unity in the truth, in a denomination in one's own country, or with sister churches abroad with a like precious faith. We believe not only the unity of the church, but its Catholicity. We believe a Catholic or universal church. When the Apostles' Creed was written, Christians did not know about North or South America, but they believed in a Catholic church. When the Heidelberg Catechism was written, Christians didn't know there was an Australia or a New Zealand, but they still believed a Catholic church. Even if a Christian's geography is none too hot, or even if someone lived in an age before all the land masses of our world were discovered, the Christian still believes in the Catholicity of the church. I'll give you one example. Even in the Old Testament, Isaiah 53, the sufferings of Jesus Christ on the cross, dying for the sins of all of his people. And what's the next verse? Isaiah 54, verse 1, calls the church in the Old Testament, Israel, to sing and rejoice because she's going to have a lot of children. Verse 2, enlarge the place of thy tent. Let them stretch forth the curtains of thine habitations. Spare not, lengthen thy cords and strengthen thy stakes. You're going to have to enlarge your tent because an awful lot of children are coming in. Because the Messiah has died, and as fruit of his death, the Jews are going to be swamped, as verse 3 goes on to say, with the Gentiles. They're going to flood in, that is, the church is going to become Catholic. Of course, Jesus is the Catholic Christ. This is Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews, in Latin, Greek, and Hebrew. He's going to see the Catholic or universal church. And since we believe the Catholicity of the church, everybody is accepted as a member, irrespective of their age, or their intellectual ability, or their sex, or their skin color, or their wealth, or the place of their birth, because the same test applies to all. Can you answer yes, not just to one or two, but all three of these three questions? Do you believe the doctrines taught in the scriptures and in our Reformed faith and taught here in this Christian church to the true and complete doctrine of salvation? Man or woman, young or old, black or white, rich or poor, do you promise to live a new and godly life? Yeah, you're in. You're in. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what color of hair you have, or the color of your eyes, or the size of your bank account. Do you promise to submit to church government and to church discipline if you should be delinquent? I've just paraphrased, you understand, the three questions asked at Confession of Faith. That's it. Same standard applies to everybody. Biblical, spiritual standards. And then there's the holiness. And somebody says, oh, but there's so much unholiness than the church world. Well, yes. It may disgust you, but it should hardly surprise you. Because most of the church world isn't the true church. It's a harlot. That's the way harlots behave. And much of what is left in the true churches consists of hypocrites or unbelievers. They're totally depraved. What do you expect? And even more seriously, even true believers in true churches only have a small beginning of the new obedience. So why in the world would you be surprised? Now all the true members of true churches are regenerated and born again. Principally they are holy, definitively. New life has been planted in them. They are growing in grace, progressive sanctification. They're being brought to faith and repentance. The path of the just, it's a shining light that shines more and more onto the perfect day. Jesus Christ is busy with his bride, the church, sanctifying it and cleansing it by the washing of water, by the word. But entire sanctification belongs to the next world. The holiness of the church means we are holy, yes, to some degree. And we're called to repent and keep on repenting and mortifying the deeds of the flesh. And we're called to put on the new man. Lastly, the fourth attribute of the church. She's one, holy, Catholic, and apostolic. And apostolic has nothing to do with clinging to places that the apostles once journeyed to, like Rome or Jerusalem or Ephesus. It has nothing to do with the supposed apostolic succession by ordination through bishops. And there is no office of bishop anyway that the Bible talks about. Apostolic is holding fast to apostolic doctrine, which is taught in the New Testament, which then interprets the Old Testament too. That's what it is to be apostolic. Ephesians 2 verse 20. The true church is, quote, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. That is apostolic, which is built on that foundation, with Jesus Christ himself being the church cornerstone. And when you believe apostolic truth in a true church, it changes your faith and your life, and it changes your family's faith and life, and influences and changes your church's faith and life. Because a church built upon the apostles and prophets, all the building, fitly framed together on this foundation, grows unto an holy temple of the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. There was a lot there. I'm going to read you question answer 54. And when I read it to you, you'll say, I understand what that means now. A whole lot more than I did. What believest thou concerning the holy Catholic Church of Christ? That the Son of God, from the beginning to the end of the world, gathers, defends, and preserves to himself, by his Spirit and Word, out of the whole human race, a church chosen to everlasting life and agreeing in true faith, and that I am, and forever shall remain, a living member thereof. Amen. Our Father in heaven, work by thy word and spirit here that we manifest ourselves more and more as a true and faithful church. Make us to grow in unity, Catholicity, and apostolicity, and holiness. And cause us, Lord, to believe the church, even when this world seems to deny the truth. For we ask in Jesus' name, Amen.